nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Hey everyone, welcome to lecture 4.7. So we just kind of motivated the concept of finite element method in the last lecture, and now we're going to explain how that would work in more detail. Remember, the point of the finite element model was that we have high resolution where we need it, and then we have low resolution where we don't need it. Okay. And so how are you going to basically set up and formulate this problem? So typically it would be written as a matrix algebra type problem in the form that LU, where L is the stiffness matrix times some unknown matrix, is equal to B, where B is the integral of our PDE with respect to whatever basis we've chosen. And L is basically representing the overlap between basis functions from adjacent triangles or other finite elements that we're looking at. And so the value of finite element analysis, like I mentioned, basically we can make elements vary in size so that some are smaller if we need them to be, but then also the speed is also kind of the downstream benefit, which is that you can have what's called compact support, which means that basically that stiffness matrix L that I just showed has only a small number of terms, mostly near the diagonal. Now, of course, there are some potential disadvantages. Mathematically, this is more complex than a uniform grid, where we already are guaranteed a sparse matrix and compact support effectively in the real space grid. And another challenge, which may even be more severe, is that you may have to perform expensive matrix inversion. But of course, having a sparse matrix can help a lot with that problem. So just to recap what the finite element objects look like, and then remember that the number of vertices is d plus 1. So in one dimension, it's basically like a line segment. So it's very simple. In two dimensions, it's a triangle usually. And then, of course, in 3D, it's like a tetrahedron. And so then oftentimes you'd represent whatever function you're looking at, whether it's E field or some temperature or whatever, as basically something like this. So it could have like a constant term and then a linear term in X direction, plus perhaps maybe a quadratic term. And so you can have different orders of finite elements as well. So you're not necessarily limited to only one type. But of course, if it's linear, then that's going to be computationally faster. But then it may lose a bit of accuracy. So then choosing the right finite element will actually depend on the problem. Of course, in a similar fashion, you'll see that in 2D and 3D, of course, you'll have elements in all of the k directions. So if you thought of it as a 2D problem, you have like a constant plus like an alpha k in the x direction, and then a beta y in the y direction, gamma z in the z direction. And so then oftentimes we find that it's computationally convenient to define these so-called Lagrange functions to represent our overall function in the linear case that I was talking about earlier. And so basically the Lagrange functions are defined like this. So if you have an interval in 1D that goes from xe0 to xe1, so basically represented along the x-axis going from here to here, then we would have a Lagrange function lambda naught that basically is our original function times this line that's going downwards, and then we have this lambda 1 going up. And so then we can actually write down these phi 1s as basically a sum of lambda 1 for this first element plus lambda naught for the second element. And then we can have lambda one for the second element plus lambda naught for the third element, and so on. So then this creates like this triangular array of points. This is discussed in more detail in this book by Asad Zadeh about finite element method for differential equations. So you can actually go into the details in that book. But effectively, what it tells us is that we can have like a nice representation that would cover the whole grid in 1D, 2D, or 3D, and would have compact support using Lagrange functions. And so in order to determine that this actually can be a useful solution to our basic problem, LU equals B, then we actually define an error function, which measures the deviation from what it should be, which is LU minus B equals zero. And so this is basically how we capture that. And so then the best way usually to minimize the errors is that we would have some sort of residual WI that multiplies LU minus B. And then at each point in the so-called test space, where we basically are setting off all of our different elements, then when we integrate over the interval, then we would get an average of zero. So there may be small errors here and there, but we're trying to make the errors cancel each other out. And so in the so-called Galerkin method, then we would actually choose a specific weighted residual called psi in order to achieve this. In the next lecture, we'll actually explain in more detail basically how to use Galerkin's method and show a simple example that will set us up for the later problems.